Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live on Martin Luther King Day here in the United States. Always a Monday. It's Martin Luther King Monday, so a very happy day to you wherever you are in the United States. Probably the prime, Darren, you have to correct me if I'm wrong, but the prime celebration of the whole civil rights movement, Martin Luther King Day, right? Today. Yeah, we don't have another bigger than this. So we do celebrate all the many successes of the civil rights movement and of the person, Dr. Martin Luther King, on this day, wherever you are around the world. And I know you, wherever you are, you know who Dr. King is. We're going to have a wonderful show for you. The second hour, we'll have a bioethics. We'll do bioethics talk. And as you might expect, that'll be Father Tad Pacholczyk who will join us. So if you got bioethics questions, questions about the care for human life in any of its stages, about medical innovations and what's okay, what's not okay, give us a call second hour for that. This hour, especially because we got lots and lots of people off of work today and we get a chance to talk to folks we don't usually get to talk to. Why are you pro-choice? If you're a pro-choice person, we would love to talk with you about that. We are pro-life people. We don't hide that, but we love talking with everybody. And if you are a pro-choice person and you want to tell us about why, give us a call, 888-318-7884. You'll be talking with our guest, Trent Horn, one of the great pro-life advocates in the world today, the author of a whole bunch of books, including a couple that are pro-life right now. We've got a booklet that, I don't know, they're going to get a million copies, 2 million copies, 10 million copies. I don't know how many of the new pro-life books, booklets from Trent out into the world. Trent Horn, thanks for being with us.
Good to be here.
How's Texas going?
Oh, it's great. You know, we the weather fluctuates a bit here. We had a weather today that did rival Southern California, but then it's going to dip back down here soon, which I didn't providentially do it. God would have providentially did it. I'll be visiting California soon when the weather gets cold here to film my new course answering Protestant arguments at our studio in Oceanside in Southern California. So it'd be nice to get out of the cold here a little bit and enjoy some San Diego weather for a bit, as long as your guys' rain is done.
Yeah, I was going to ask if you didn't know that we're in an atmospheric river. I mean, this is the worst thing.
You're like in an atmospheric ocean. It hasn't let up.
No, it really hasn't. It has been raining quite a bit. But it's just rain, Trent. It's just rain. And you know, the thing about California, it's such a big state, like a road washes out somewhere and CNN shows up and then the relatives from back east calling, are you all right? Well, yeah, a road washed out 700 miles from here, but I think we're okay. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. For you, Trent, is there any relationship between the pro-life position and the whole battle for civil rights? Do you see it as a civil rights type battle?
Absolutely, because the goal of the pro-life movement is to expand the circle of human concern, right? In fact, that's the goal of all human rights movements, really. If you think about when we look at what has been the mark of progress in human societies over the past several thousand years, it's that those individuals that were once considered to be less than human are now considered to be fully human. And throughout history, it's very interesting. Throughout history, whenever a group of powerful people have said that a group of humans are not persons or they're not fully human, they've always been wrong. We saw this with Africans, with dark-skinned people, with Asian Americans who immigrated to the United States. We saw that with Native Americans, with Jewish people throughout history. In all these cases, the claim that this group is not fully human, even though they're biologically human, has always been mistaken. So to me, that really makes it seem quite probable that those who say unborn human beings are not human are also just as mistaken as well. The idea that they're not fully human. And so that's what we're trying to do, is to expand the circle of the human community to include all members of the human species. And that would seem to be a very equitable and fair thing to do.
Again, the number is 888-318-7884 if you disagree with us on this point, if you are a pro-choice person. Listen, a pro-choice, take it however you want. If you if you say, you know, well, I don't believe in abortion in the last trimester, does that make me pro-choice? Yeah, if you are in favor of abortion in any stage, if you're then you are you're fair. It's fair for you to call today as a pro-choice person. Why are you pro-choice is our topic. 888-318-7884. A perfect day for it on this Martin Luther King Day here in the United States. 888-318-7884. Before I go to the phones, because there are folks on the line, there are a couple of lines still open, but we're still processing the folks on the phones. We really do want to talk to pro-choice people today, and so we're making sure that each caller is a pro-choice person who has a pro-choice point of view. Tell us about the book, Trent, the newest pro-life book that you did, Why We're Pro-Life.
Right, so this is more of a booklet than a book, and that makes it very easy to hand out to people. So it's short, takes about a 30-minute read, and it is written in a tone, like my book, Why We're Catholic, in a tone and a style that is accessible, that is not confrontational, that is something that you could give to a pro-choice friend or classmate and read, and they would understand the basics of the pro-life position. And it's also written so that the references to religion come at the end of the booklet, so that those who believe the pro-life position is merely a religious position won't just be turned off immediately as they start reading it. They'll see that it quite accords with the principles of the moral law that any rational person can understand and detect. So yeah, Why We're Pro-Life, I'm super excited. We want to give that away to schools, to pregnancy centers, to churches. We'd love for you to hand it out. It's a great resource to give away, and we hope lots of you will pick up boxes for that, especially as we come around to the commemoration of Roe versus Wade here in January, though I hope this will be the last commemoration of Roe v. Wade we ever do, and we just give it another 18 months, and in June of 2024, we then gather to commemorate Dobbs versus Jackson, and to commemorate the next step in the pro-life fight.
You know, you'll take away the main thing about the Walk for Life, however, the walking in freezing cold, drizzly rain. We won't have that if we do it in June. Are you trying to mess that up?
You know, I think that the Supreme Court just. It was providential there that they decided to hold out at the very last minute and then release it. Although what's interesting here is that most controversial cases are released at the end of the Supreme Court's term. That's been something that's happened more recently. I'm sure the court operated a little bit differently back in 1973, I guess. So
again, 888-318-7884, the number, 888-31-TRUTH. We have already had our Walk for Life here in San Diego. We had it on Saturday, and the cardinal from here in San Diego, I thought, did a very nice job in answering reporters' questions. You know, they go for the big name, and of course, if you got a cardinal, then that's the big name. And he did a very nice job about it, and I wanted to mention it because I do think a lot of times people have complained that bishops aren't adequately pro-life and all that. And I thought it was just wonderful to see the cardinal, without any drama or any obfuscating, just saying we're standing up for life. We believe in the sanctity of life, and we think everybody should stand up for the sanctity of life. I know people outside the Catholic Church think it's obvious what the Catholic Church position is, but often Catholics are kind of fussy at the bishops for not doing more.
Yeah, and it's. I mean, it's always hard, right? You want to see people going out, and you might have expectations that are realistic that are not met, or expectations that are unrealistic. But I think what's important here is to just continue to ask our pastors and our shepherds to make our spiritual needs known, and especially to, as you're doing right here, Si, to praise them and thank them for speaking up for the unborn, which can be very difficult, and for taking risks in doing that, because if they don't hear that and get blowback from secular media or from others in the church who are not very sympathetic to the pro-life viewpoint, they might be less willing to do that. So we should definitely affirm people when they're speaking difficult truths to society.
Yeah, and you said taking a risk. I mean, nowadays, walking at the very front of a pro-life march, you kind of do feel like you're taking a risk. And there he was right out in the front. So I was very grateful to see that.
Yeah.
Let's go to Bob in Springfield, Illinois, listening to EWTN on Channel 130 Sirius XM satellite radio. Bob, thank you for your call. Why are you pro-choice?
Hey, yes. Happy New Year. And
thank you.
Thanks for being on the air. I listen to you occasionally now and then, and I just had three areas that I thought about where it's challenging, and one would be a birth defect, one would be a rape victim, and one would be incest. A third would be incest. So, like a rape victim, I remember reading about a woman who was Catholic, and she gave birth instead of having an abortion. But then what happened in that state, the rapist served his 7 years for rape and then came out and wanted to share custody. So she had to give up her daughter to this rapist, okay, because the judges decided that this is the father and he has right to the child, okay?
Sure.
And other states would maybe say no. But then, two, if you have a birth defect, in an extreme case, and that's what kind of pressed me to think, well, how can you go post-birth abortion, you know? But then if you have a child that's born with severe birth defects, you know, then, and you know that ahead of time, then you might say, you know, and depending early on, you might abort the child, you know, like some of these people that have like two heads or the heart's out of the chest and it's beating outside the chest.
Well, Bob, I hate to jump in here. We have to go to a break here very soon, our first break. So I'd like to address that particular point, and then I can address, I'll talk about birth defects, and I'll address your question about the issue of rape when we come back from the break. But when it comes to a child who has a fetal anomaly or a birth defect, what we should ask is, all right, what would we do if this were a born child? Like, what if a two-year-old injured himself with his father's handgun and was dying or was going to be lifelong seriously injured? Because you can have children or adults who become seriously injured, or you can have children who have a birth defect that was missed during the pregnancy and was discovered after birth, like Tay-Sachs, or even in some cases Down syndrome or other cases, you might miss a particular birth defect until the child's born. So if we would not kill a child after they're born because they have an illness, a disability, or some other injury, if we would not kill a born child for that reason, then I would say we should not kill an unborn child for the same reason, because they're both human. If you say it's okay to kill a child in the womb because he or she has a birth defect, then there's no logical reason to say you can't kill a two-year-old who has an injury or an illness or something like that. But as to the question of rape and other issues, I'd be happy to address that when we come back.
All right, we'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Why Are You Pro-Choice on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live. Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The destination for great Catholic audio programming is EWTN Podcast Central, featuring the best of EWTN radio, as well as faith-filled podcasts from our friends and affiliates across the nation. All in one place, all free. If it's central to the faith, you can find it on EWTN Podcast Central. It's like podcast heaven. Visit EWTN.com/radio/podcasts today.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm going to go back to our conversation between Trent and Bob in Springfield. We're asking callers, why are you pro-choice? And please leave the lines open for them, because Sarah's in there working hard to get every call screened. And we really would just like to speak with pro-choice people today. We'll leave the phones for everybody else on the other days. The number is 888-318-7884. If you're a pro-choice person and you'd like to call and tell us why and have some conversation about that, we would love that. We'd really appreciate it, as a matter of fact. 888-318-7884. Trent, are we going back to Bob, or did you want to?
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
Well, we can go back to Bob if he has any questions in that regard. Because I wanted to also follow up about rape, and I'll give a similar reply that what you describe, like someone who is a victim of rape becomes pregnant, and then when their child is 7 or 8 years old, has to share custody with the rapist who's never been involved in this child's life at all prior to that point, I would say that does seem very unjust to me and wrong. But I would say once again, even if we don't know what the right answer is for what to do with parental rights in cases of children conceived through rape, we can at least know what not to do. We can at least know, well, here's definitely what we shouldn't do. We definitely shouldn't kill the child. We definitely shouldn't do that. And because the thing is, you can have messy child custody cases with born children. It happens all the time. You can have all kinds of cases where you have, you know, a father who's committed a crime, and maybe a crime against the mother, maybe assault. Maybe they had an abusive relationship and they've separated, and then the father is given custody later, even if it's unjust that he's given it. And then, well, what do we do in those cases? Well, do we kill the child so the child doesn't have to be shared in this situation? No, we work to resolve whatever injustice has occurred. So just as we would not kill a born child because he or she has a defect or injury or illness or is the victim of a messy custody dispute, we should not kill an unborn child for the same reason. So that would be, I guess, my reply to that. But Bob, does that that should cover really all three, because incest is kind of a combination. But does that make sense?
Yeah, Bob. Really, it's like checkmate. Really, I mean, you answered that answer has all three of those concerns. It's just a messy situation, and it's a sad situation. Yeah. But I think that answer was checkmate. So you win. Not win, but you made a good point. God bless.
That's fine.
Thank you, Bob.
That's fine with me.
I've never had a caller declare Trent the winner before. That was the first time that's happened. Congratulations, Trent. You can receive your trophy later. But I do appreciate that thoughtful call. It's just, I mean, it's interesting, like taking from what you just said, Trent, we don't always know how to solve these problems, but we know what not to do. You know, we know
that's important to remember.
Yeah, yeah. Let's go to Kaylin in Omaha, Nebraska, listening on Spirit Catholic Radio. Kaylin, thank you for your call. Go ahead with you. Oh, no, excuse me. I should say it this way. Why are you pro-choice, Kaylin?
Yeah, so I apologize if I told the screener if today's not the right day for this question that I can drop off, but it's not. I'm not pro-choice. I actually had a more of a general question kind of related to the pro-life, pro-choice argument. So,
okay.
I know a few people in my life who are IVF babies, and I was just wondering if Trent could speak on essentially why IVF is wrong.
Sure. And to put it in the context of the pro-life movement, there is a difference of opinion among pro-life advocates when it comes to the subject of in vitro fertilization. So in vitro fertilization, or IVF, occurs when fertilization takes place outside of the woman's body. So you take sperm from the man, egg from the woman. You then fertilize them in a petri dish, create a human embryo, or in some cases, multiple human embryos, and then implant them in the mother's womb. Now, I think all pro-lifers are against IVF when it results in the destruction of human embryos. This isn't as common as it was before, but it still happens where you have embryos that are multiple embryos that are created, screened, and then they are destroyed either before implantation or they are placed within the mother's body, the woman's body, mother, and then maybe they are euphemistically selectively reduced or aborted. So I think pro-lifers would say that at least on that front, you are creating human beings knowing that you're going to directly kill some of them. And that would be wrong, because we'd say it's wrong to directly kill human beings. So as long if there is an IVF process where that is intrinsically connected, that would be a major reason why it is wrong. But another reason that like the Catholic Church would affirm would be that IVF, while so in some cases it violates a child's right to life, like if they are an extra embryo that is destroyed purposely. In other cases, in all cases though, so in some cases that happens, but let's say you just create one embryo, right? Well, you would still violate the child's right to come into existence through the marital act and to reside inside of his mother's body. So an unborn child, the reason abortion is wrong, because you'll get people who will say, oh, well, yeah, it's a baby, but it doesn't have a right to his mother's body without her consent. And the reply to that is, no, not only is this child a baby, a human being, he has a right to life, and not just a right to life, he has a right to the assistance of the woman who brought him into existence, one of his parents, his mother. So he has a right to food and shelter and being cared for within his mother's body. Part of his right to life entails the right to his mother's body. So unborn children have a right not just to live, but a right to reside in their mother's body. And IVF would violate that right by causing them to no longer be the fruit of the marital act, and instead objectify them and cause them to be the result of a manufacturing process. Now, with a caveat here, I will say this. Look, children who are conceived in IVF are good. They have immortal souls. They are blessed in God's eyes. So they are good, even if the means that they came into existence is not good. There's many children who come into existence through fornication, right? People have sex outside of marriage. And those children are good, but the way they came into existence isn't good, because children have a right to come into existence through the marital act. What that means is, as soon as they come into existence, they are the fruit of the love of a mother and father who are husband and wife. The husband and wife are united to each other, and so they are there for that child, and the child is within his mother's body. Now, Kaylin, you may say, yeah, well, that's all very theoretical. What's the big deal if you have a husband and wife and they're infertile? Why can't they do this process to have that child, okay? Well, another argument I make here to help people wrap their heads around that would be somewhat of a practical one, but it explains the principles. And that would be this. Once you open the door and say there's nothing wrong with creating a child because somebody wants a child, say, I want a child, all right? And I want to treat my infertility. Now, we should always treat infertility. But children are not a medical treatment. No one has, as the catechism says, no one has a right to a child. No one does. Children are a gift. So if we say that, well, what do we do then to treat a married couple who want a children? What about an unmarried person who wants a child? What about the unmarried person who says, I can't find anyone to marry me, so I want a child? It might be an unmarried woman who uses a sperm donor. It could be an unmarried man who uses a sperm donor, an egg. He could use a sperm donor, an egg donor, and a gestational surrogate, and have a child basically delivered to him. You don't have a principled way to say they shouldn't be allowed to do that if you're grounding IVF and saying, well, it's people have a right to a child, they have the right to do this to have a child. That the commodification of it becomes obvious when you look at many of these other cases. Where you have now, you have people who come into existence who have five parents: the sperm donor, the egg donor, the gestational surrogate, and the two parents who adopt them, you know. So, which would contradict God's design for human beings don't reproduce. You might reproduce a copy of a document in a fax machine or whatever. We procreate. We create and partner with God to bring a new immortal soul, new human being into existence. But so that would be a summary of it. But Kaylin, if you would like more, if you give us your email, I will send you a copy of my friend Stephanie Gray Connor's book, Conceived by Science. And it's a whole book about IVF that it expands upon what I talked about. So give us your email address. We got a few minutes where we have to go to a break. Was that at least a helpful start?
Yeah, that's awesome. That was way more than I could have asked for. Thank you so much.
Well, good. But then stay on the line. Give us your email address, and I'll send you a copy of Steph's book.
Yeah.
And for our listeners, definitely pick that up. I believe it's called Conceived by Science. Yeah. Stephanie Gray Connor's on IVF.
She did a job there that no one else has done, and it really was a service, that book. So
yes.
I hope people will get that book. Let's go. Kaylin, you hang on, and Sarah will pick up the phone and get your information. And I'm going to go to Loretta in Colorado, listening on 970 AM. Loretta. Why are you pro-choice?
Hi,
Loretta.
I'm reluctantly pro-choice because I don't want these things done. I don't want women self-aborting. I don't want them going to... I'm old enough to remember when they did do this, and women died. Girls died. Some didn't go to the doctor. They were too afraid. So I think that's what will happen. I think that a lot of that is going to take place, and I just think nobody in this country is forced to get an abortion. No one. And as long as it's that way, now, if the president would say tomorrow, people, girls, have to get an abortion if they're 13 or younger, if he made a rule like that. But nobody has to. But the other thing is I have
Loretta,
talked to
Loretta, we
so
have to go
many...
to a break in a sec. Loretta, hold on. We have to go to a break in a second. So I'd like to ask you a question because I'm trying to get at your reasoning here. So here's my honest question. Can you give me an example involving born people where we make it legal for one born person to kill another born person so that it's safer for them? Like, is there any example you can think of with born people where we say, hey, this bigger born person wants to kill this smaller born person, let's at least make it legal so it's safer for the bigger person because they're going to do it anyways?
Oh, I feel...
See, I'm not disagreeing with you. I'm saying, yes, it's wrong. But
okay,
but
let's when we come back from the break, I want to we'll dive into it more.
Can you hang on just a minute because I have to go to this break, Loretta. Can you hang on?
Okay.
Okay, thank you so much. Why are you pro-choice this hour? If you are a pro-choice person and you'd like to talk about it, 888-318-7884. The recent decision by the U.S. Supreme Court to overturn Roe v. Wade was a monumental victory for the pro-life movement. But the fight is far from over. With our new booklet, Why We're Pro-Life, we have produced the perfect tool to prepare you to have peaceful and convincing conversations to shed light on the truth about human life from conception to natural death. Catholic Answers is printing millions of copies of this booklet, and we plan simply to give them away. You can help us in two ways. First, by generously supporting this project. 25 cents prints one book. $2,500 prints 10,000, and so on. Second, by helping us distribute the booklet through your parish, your school, or the pro-life ministry you work with. Catholic Answers is going to blanket the country with Why We're Pro-Life, but only if you step up and help us. Thank you so much. For more information, visit whywearepro-life.com.
If you're not a Bible scholar, the full message of how the Sunday Mass readings fit together can be tough to comprehend. Apologist Carlo Broussard is here to help. Join Carlo every Friday for the Sunday Catholic Word Podcast. In each episode, he unpacks the scripture readings for that Sunday and brings them all together so you can better understand and defend the faith. Visit SundayCatholicWord.com to subscribe. That's SundayCatholicWord.com.
Catholic Answers Live is 25 years old. That's a quarter century helping people come into deeper communion with the Catholic faith. As we move into our second quarter century, please help us reach thousands more by becoming a Society 315 monthly donor. Right now, when you join Society 315 at a monthly giving level of $25 or more, we've added some extra perks to the other great benefits we already offer members. Go to givecatholic.com and choose the monthly option to start your donation.
Hi, this is Janet Williams. Please join us for Women of Grace tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. On this Martin Luther King Day here in the U.S., it's a day off for lots of people in the U.S., but this is not a pre-record. We're live, so you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. If you are a pro-choice person, that's what we're doing this hour. Trent Horn is our guest, and we're inviting pro-choice listeners to call and have that discussion with us about why they are pro-choice. 888-318-7884. Loretta in Colorado is on the line. And Loretta, you were saying before we had to go to that break that you basically agree with Trent.
I agree that it's wrong. I agree that it's taking a life. I told you why I want it to remain legal. There are girls that don't agree with this, and they're going to go get these abortions anyway. And when I ask pro-choice people, okay, it's murder, what are we going to do with these women that do this? I don't know. You can't, you know, I just talked to a priest this morning. He said even among priests, they can't agree. So I'm going to ask you that question. What are we going to do with these women when it's made illegal and you find out she's had an abortion? What are you going to do to her?
I'm sorry. So if someone has had an abortion, what will be done to them if it's illegal?
No, when you make it illegal, When you make it illegal, a girl that goes and has one anyway, what is the punishment?
Well, in the states right now where abortion is illegal, women are not punished. The laws are crafted to punish the abortion providers.
Okay, and that's
I live in
wrong.
One of those states.
Because a woman will can self-abort and not even involve anybody. What are you going to do to her? I'm talking, you know what I'm asking you.
Well, I don't know how the law would...
A woman who is totally responsible for her abortion, what are you going to do to her?
So you're saying the person...
And that's exactly the answer I always get.
Loretta, isn't she responsible for choosing to have an abortion instead of choosing to give birth?
Yes, and what are you going to do to
her? So should she be held responsible for her free decision?
Yes, yes. What should you do to her?
Okay. I don't know how it would apply in that case. There may be a legal punishment. There might not.
All the time.
But why does that bother you? Why does I don't know bother you?
Because I've talked to so many people and they're so.
Loretta, let me ask you a parallel question. Let's say a girl gets pregnant, right? And she's not able to get an abortion, and she gives birth to the baby, and she just abandons the baby in the woods, and the baby dies. What should be done with her?
She should be punished, but if you're going to punish
How should she be punished?
Well, if she's in her right mind, which I don't even know if she'd be in her right mind, you have to look at the circumstance. But I'm giving you a circumstance that is very clear. A woman has self-aborted.
Okay, then why can't I give you the same answer? A woman who self-aborts should be punished, but it would be based on the circumstance and her state of mind. I just gave the exact same answer you did.
Well, okay, should you put her in prison?
Would you put the woman who abandons her newborn in prison?
You know what I'm saying. I'm talking about the woman who self-aborts. What I'm telling you is, to me, that is her punishment. The abortion is the punishment. She has to live with it. And anything else you do is just, it's not going to work. I'll tell you, it's just not. I think that's why it became legal. It's because it didn't work when it was illegal.
Why do you think that there should... I'm trying to figure out, you agree that abortion kills a human being.
Yes, it's wrong. I agree.
And in other cases, we should punish people who kill born human beings, right?
Right. Right.
Then why don't you why don't you give the unborn the same respect and hold those who end their lives just as responsible? I don't understand.
I'm not disagreeing with you. With you. What I'm saying is it's not going to work.
How do you know it's not going to work?
For example, it wasn't legal before, and women still self-aborted or went to abortionists.
Okay, Loretta, let me ask you this: if you burglary and rape are illegal, but they still happen, right?
Right.
Okay, but they would happen a lot more if they were legal, correct?
Well, I don't know about that. Then it wouldn't be if it's not against the law, then I don't know. I'm not following
if it was legal to steal things, do you think people would steal more?
I don't know. It wouldn't be a crime then, kind of trying to follow you a little bit.
Loretta, Loretta, we have laws against crimes. They don't stop all crimes, but they stop a lot of them. We actually have the data now from abortion having been made illegal in many cases in Georgia and here in Texas, that the overall numbers of abortions have gone down, and we don't see rampant illegal abortions taking place or self-administered abortions. And we've actually known this for quite a while, that there was a study done many years ago called the Turnaround Study showing 4,000 women who couldn't get an abortion because they were too far along in their pregnancy. And what these women did is they didn't go out and get illegal abortions, they just had the child. And that's what we're seeing now in states, in what's happening now with abortion as it's being made illegal in a lot of various states. But I would just go back to the main moral principle, and that would be that we should make it illegal to kill innocent human beings. There may be cases where we're not sure what the punishment ought to be given the different circumstances that are involved. However, we should protect the unborn just like we protect other born people and not make them less worthy of protection just because they're unborn, I suppose. But thank you so much for calling. We have a few other callers here on the line waiting. And yeah, feel free to call back anytime.
The number is 888-318-7884. We really do enjoy the conversations with pro-choice people, and we appreciate the calls. More than anything, I want you to know we appreciate the call. So if you are a pro-choice person and you're willing to have that conversation with us, we would love to have that conversation. 888-318-7884. Up next, an anonymous caller listening on the EWTN website. Anonymous, thank you so much for your call. Why are you pro-choice?
Yes, good evening. Let's see, I'm actually pro-life now, but I was pro-choice for a long time. In my 20s and 30s, I would say I was pro-choice and thinking a woman had the right to choose about her body. But I think I didn't understand if there really was a person there in the womb. And then I studied actually Buddhism for 10 years and Mahayana Buddhism, because some people might say, well, the Buddhism I know doesn't talk about that, but certain Mahayana Buddhism scriptures, they describe precisely how the soul enters at the moment of conception, exactly like how the process happens. So according to those scriptures, it agrees with Catholicism that right. A being is there at the moment of conception. So abortion would be killing because there is a being, there is a soul there. So that changed my mind. So
Trent, what do you make of that?
Well, I think that that's very helpful to know that, you know, it's not just a Christian view on the matter, that other people can see that if you have a developing human organism, that if you believe in a spiritual principle of life, it makes a lot of sense to say, well, that spiritual principle of life is present when the organism first begins to exist, which science shows is the case at conception or fertilization. Now, the question of ensoulment has not been infallibly taught by the church. There were some earlier saints and doctors like Augustine or Thomas Aquinas who placed ensoulment later in pregnancy, but they had a mistaken view about the biology of development. If they knew about DNA now and human development, they probably have a much different view. The most recent magisterial documents seem to affirm placing ensoulment earlier, even at conception. Now, it hasn't been infallibly defined. My colleague Tim Staples has written an article about this at Catholic.com, where he makes the case that in the church's non-infallible teaching, that this has been affirmed in different documents, that at the very least, it says that the human embryo from conception onward is to be respected as a person. Even if we don't detect the moment when the soul enters the body, we can know there is a human life here, and human life has an intrinsic value that other human beings do not have. But you can check that out at Catholic.com, Tim Staples' recent essay on that. And yeah, Anonymous, I hope that's helpful. If you stay on the line, Anonymous, I would love to send you a copy of my book, Why We're Catholic, because you might also find that helpful for other questions you may have as well. So do stay on the line. Love to send you Why We're Catholic. And yeah, I hope that it helps you in everything you're looking at.
Thank you so much, Anonymous, for that call. That brings us right to the break. We do have lots of lines open. One call we will get to right when we get back. And then if you'd like to be in the line behind that one, give us a call. 888-318-7884. If you're a pro-choice person, this is your opportunity to let us know why you are pro-choice. 888-318-7884.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
What a great grace it is to have the opportunity to use the airwaves for the honor and glory of God, to be able to talk to the hearts of individuals and meet them where they are in their relationship with our Lord, and also to encourage them forward.
Women of Grace with Johnette Williams, this morning, 3 a.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. It's that time of year when we like to challenge listeners and readers to take on the 20 Answers Challenge, challenging you to read all 53 books in the 20 Answers series during 2023. As we usher in 2023, it's a great time to set goals and to challenge yourself with something that's going to benefit you and those around you. The great news is that even though we've added three new books to the sampler for the month of January, we're leaving the price the same. That's a savings of almost 75% per booklet when you buy the set of Catholic Answers 20 Answers booklets. Check them all out at shop.catholic.com, shop.catholic.com. Trent Horn is our guest this hour. Why are you pro-choice is the question of the hour. If you are a pro-choice person, we'd love to take your call, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Going to Wellesley, Massachusetts. Deirdre listening on 1060 AM. Deirdre, thanks for the call. Why are you pro-choice?
Well, actually, I told your screener that I'm actually pro-life, but I have a question that I would love the answer to.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And it seems like maybe a legal one. When people speak of babies who survive late-term abortions, and then there people are demanding them that it's still the mother's choice for the child to be killed, isn't that child automatically an American citizen with its own rights?
Well, I am not an expert in the question of birthright citizenship. I know that we have been working in different states and at the federal level to pass the Born Alive Infant Protection Acts, to pass legal protections for children who survive abortions, at least to make sure that they are given medical treatment, that they're not simply just allowed to die. Now, some of these laws, I know this was the case in Montana and others, that there was opposition placed against these laws because in some cases, let's say a child who survives a spontaneous abortion, that would be a miscarriage. There can be a case where a child is miscarried right at the border of viability, and they're essentially dying. We could maybe keep them alive, but not for very long. Their lungs just aren't developed enough. And so we would be futile to provide life-giving care because the child wouldn't survive anyways. And in that case, it's acceptable to allow the child to pass away naturally. But there's other cases where a child survives a late-term abortion, and they certainly could live, and they're simply abandoned by the abortion provider and staff, and they're just abandoned so that they will die, and you'll get the dead child that was paid for. And so there's been a lot of work been done to prevent that. Now, you would think that a child who's born, you would think a child who's born, though, hey, they're born, it's set. If you neglect them, it's a citizen, that's murder. I just think, though, it gets a little bit tricky sometimes in the way when children are born, because in order for a child to recognize it, to have citizenship, you have to have a birth certificate. Like, our third child was accidentally born at home. So technically, and this was in September of 2020, this was during COVID, it took us like 3 months to prove he was a citizen because he wasn't born in a hospital. So it was like we had to go jump through all these hoops. So it may not be as cut and dry in that respect. I agree with you. It would seem like once you're born, you're recognized as a legal person, you're a citizen, you should be protected. But I think it can get, they've carved out these niches in different environments where people can take advantage of the legal loopholes. But I'm sorry if I couldn't give a more specific answer there, but that's why I would recommend that people support legal initiatives to make sure to close any loopholes that would allow an abortion provider to neglect to provide basic care to a child who survives an abortion because they simply want the child's life to end. So definitely be aware of those legislative efforts in your state and get out and support them. I think we had that at the federal level, but there were a lot of people who voted against it as well. But thank you, thank you, Deirdre, for your call on that.
All right. Good night.
Good night, Deirdre. Yeah. Thanks very much. So you were your child was not a legal citizen. So were you, like, for the first 3 months, does that make you a smuggler, or what were you doing there?
No, I think it was. I will tell you this side, because he was not an American citizen, like, communicating with him, like, he didn't understand English. It was very difficult for those first 3 months.
But eventually, it's
gotten a lot easier now that he's gotten his citizenship. So, yeah.
He's a citizen of these United States. That's funny. I forgot that happened during COVID. So then it's even harder because they don't want you to come down to the courthouse or anything.
It was the most expensive ambulance ride we ever had. At first, they tried to charge us for labor and delivery of the child for our bill. And we said, no, I did all that at home. You should be paying me for doing your work. So they charged us. It was like $12,000 for the ambulance ride or something. I was like, no, we did labor and delivery at home. You can't bill us for that. So they just billed us the same amount for delivery of the placenta in the ambulance.
Did they really?
They did.
Man.
Oh, they did.
What a scam. I got to, boy, any way to get into that business? No, probably too late for me to get into that business.
Oh, it's, but I mean, it was all worth it. But I will tell you, this side was really cool is that this is our third child, John Paul, on his birth certificate, it says that father, and then there's this thing for like the person who delivered the child or like mediated the birth, whatever that part is, that I'm listed in both those places. So that's pretty cool.
Oh, it's you on. Yeah, that's right. Why are you pro-choice this hour? If you're a pro-choice person, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. I notice as I keep going to these calls, though, well, I'm not pro-choice. So that keeps happening. But let's try Steve here in California. Steve, why are you pro-choice?
As you said, Edgar, you nailed me. I was, when I was younger, back in 73, I was guilty twice. But when you get of any age and any understanding, that's what drove me to the Catholic Church, and still is, as you guys know, is your teaching on this subject and other issues that are strong. Come on, I'm not the Lone Ranger who's done this, but Lord God, now it's past any lying. Back at them, there was no scanning, nothing. They didn't, you know, they can lie to you. I believe the government. No, I don't believe the government. But anyways, that's a different subject. But I just want to say thank you for having this difficult subject. I appreciate it, which draws me to your apostolate. And God bless you guys for this.
Oh, thank you, Steve.
Amen, my friend. Praying for you and your healing, but thank you for that.
You know, it's fascinating, Trent, and I am going to go to the callers, even though I've completely lost trust in the callers today. I am going to go to them. But this is something, I know Patrick Madrid wrote a book about this, but not enough people talk about it. The pro-life position, people go, Catholics need to get with the times. The pro-life position actually attracts many people to the Catholic Church.
Yes, the book is called Surprised by Life, and it's a really great anthology of conversions through the pro-life community.
888-318-7884. Will you just tell Sarah, I'm just going to go straight to line one, so if she'll just let me have the line, then I will go to Cheryl. And where is, I can't see because she's still typing. Cheryl in South Indiana. I'm so glad that you are here, Cheryl. Why are you pro-choice, Cheryl?
Okay. I'm pro-choice because there are times when women's, not just their life is in danger, but their health is in danger. Mm-hmm. That I've known of a friend who would have physically been permanently damaged if she had gone through with the pregnancy. Now, what I think the issue really is for most people, most people don't think abortion, say, should exist in the 7th and 8th and 9th month. Mm-hmm. Okay. But people believe that abortion can exist in the first and second month. Mm-hmm. The issue about whether a conception, life ends at conception, all right, you have to admit there's been some discussion about that with even in the Catholic Church, with the whole concept of when do you get your soul? You know, what happens with twins when the egg divides? Does the soul divide? Mm-hmm.
Right, but Cheryl, shouldn't we, if we're trying to answer the question of when a biological human being begins to exist, shouldn't we just look at the scientific evidence? And when you do look at that, there's almost 100% agreement among biologists that a new human being comes into existence at conception or fertilization. I think that should be our foundation.
Okay, and I'm not going to disagree with you. What I'm trying to say is that in places like Indiana, people who will have conditions where a pregnancy could, injure their life or make their life more difficult physically, mm-hmm. and all because they have...
Cheryl, you there?
...sacrifice their life. Or should they have to sacrifice...
Trent,
I think we're losing Cheryl. We're losing Cheryl.
Cheryl, you're coming in and out,
but
I think Trent gets
the
idea.
I'll just give an answer to this.
Yeah, go ahead. Because you know what she's asking.
I have a practical answer and a principled one, that if you are pro-choice because you're concerned about dangers to a pregnant mother's health, then I would say, well, would you support a ban on abortion that has an exception if a woman's life is in danger, or if there is a severe irreversible damage to a major bodily function? That most laws that ban abortion in the United States have an exception if a woman's life is in danger, or if there's going to be what they would consider a severe irreversible damage to a major bodily function. Like if it's going to cause you to become blind, it's going to cause you to lose a limb, something like that. So if you're pro-choice, I'd say, well, you could support these laws that outlaw the vast majority of abortions that are done just for elective reasons, that are not done for a woman's health, they're not done for her life, they're done for a lifestyle, because you don't want to have another child, you want to continue school, you don't want to continue a relationship with someone. But then Cheryl did say something interesting. She said, well, this can make someone's life more difficult. I agree. But if pregnancy and childbirth causes your life to become difficult, whether giving birth to a child will make life difficult for a woman who is involved, for the man who is the father of that child, he has to care for that child. I have three children. Life does become more difficult when you have children. But the answer to the difficulties of raising a child cannot be legally killing that child. That's barbaric if we say that adults, that grown adults, that it's sufficient to say that they should be allowed to kill their own children because they have difficulties in life. We've all got difficulties, but we learn to resolve them with nonviolent means. That's what we do in a civilized society. So I would say that, you know, if you're looking at it in a narrow sense, like an extreme risk to health, there are exceptions to that. Though I would say from a moral perspective, you shouldn't be, it's immoral to kill someone just because they're a risk to your health. Like if I'm in a rowboat with Cy Kellett and Cy has an illness that if he gets me sick, I would go blind, I would not be justified in pushing him out of the boat to protect myself from becoming blind or something like that. I'm not allowed to kill him just to preserve my health, or even to kill him to save my own life. I know I could, you know, steady the boat to keep us both afloat. If he falls out accidentally, that's not my fault. But you can't kill other people directly just to protect yourself. Murder, necessity is not a justification for a murder in that regard. But I talk about that more at length in my book, Persuasive Pro-Life. Those who are interested can seek out that resource for these hard cases. But the fact of the matter is, vast majority of cases, it's very clear that we should protect the lives of unborn children, and there's no problem. We can protect the lives of children and their mothers. We don't have to drive a wedge between them.
Cheryl, thank you so much. I really appreciate that. We were looking for pro-choice folks to call and make reasoned arguments so we could have those kind of discussions, and you stepped up to the plate, and I appreciate it, but we are at the end of this hour. I really also am deeply touched that you didn't shove me out of the boat, Trent. I really feel like we're making progress.
I would not sigh. You're doing fine for now.
I'm safe for now in Trent's boat. All right, Father Tad Pacholczyk, we're going to talk bioethics when we come back. If you got bioethics questions, abortion questions among them, are fine. 888-318-7884. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. As promised, our guest this hour, Father Tad Pacholczyk from the National Catholic Bioethics Center. And we love these opportunities to talk about bioethics because, you know, there's the perennials in the moral realm where you have a moral question about this or that, and it's been answered for centuries. In bioethics, certainly the basics are there, or the fundamentals are there to answer those questions, but often whole new areas of inquiry have to be undertaken to know what exactly is happening in this bioethical technology or technique that's been developed, and then what's the moral meaning of whatever is happening there. And that's what they do at the National Catholic Bioethics Center, as well as anyone on the earth. Father Tad Pacholczyk, thank you very much for being here with us.
Wonderful to be able to join you. Thanks for having me again, Cy.
Is this what part of why you like doing bioethics? Because you get to put on the science mind and actually figure out what's going on in this new, I don't know, drug or technique or whatnot. And then, because you got to know the facts in order to make a moral judgment about things.
Well, you really do. I mean, you know, just to give you a kind of sideways example here, I just was looking into something called alkaline hydrolysis. Do you know what that is?
Does this involve deceased people?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
I do, and you describe it because I will be I'll be covering my ears and eyes. It really bothers me.
It's pretty hard to fathom. So it involves a process of taking a corpse, putting it into a special metal chamber, adding potassium hydroxide, heating up the chamber, and what happens is it degrades all of the flesh and all of the, you know, biological components in your skin and your tissues, just leaving bones behind. And then there's this like soupy brown effluent that they empty from the machine, and it goes into the sewer, and you get rid of it that way. And then you grind up the bones, and it's just like when you burn up the body.
Yeah, the cremation, yeah.
Cremains. You have cremains afterwards. Could I
just ask you to never say soupy brown emulsion ever again on the radio program? I'm trying to hold my lunch down now, Father.
I tell you.
All right, so what are the moral questions with this? So let me put it the way I think that a person, you know, a normal person might respond to that is, okay, that sounds kind of gross, but why would that be any different than cremation in the treatment of the body?
Yeah, that's precisely the type of thinking that we need to engage in as we look at this. And so, you know, I just wrote a short piece on this, and my conclusion was very much along those lines, that cremains are a problem on many levels, in the sense that people receive them from the funeral home, they put them, you know, in the attic, they get lost, they mishandle them. And, you know, there's also the whole question of, is this sort of fully respectful to the human body or not? And so the same set of questions arises with this alkaline hydrolysis. You end up with cremains. And how are they going to be handled? So what the church does is she says, look, you can't keep this over the fireplace on the mantle. You have to inter always the cremains in the family plot, you know, the mausoleum, whatever it is. So there's a place to go and pray for your beloved dead. So the church in general does not encourage the preparation of cremains or cremation in general, prefers whole body burial. That's sort of the bottom line. Prefers. Now, does that mean that you're not allowed to do cremation? No, of course you are allowed to, but it's the kind of thing that, you know, should require some discernment. What are the reasons, etc., that you're doing this? And I think the same thing would hold at this point for alkaline hydrolysis. The church hasn't said that it's unacceptable, but the church would say, well, you know, is this really showing respect towards the remains of our beloved dead? And are we going to make sure that if we do it out of extenuating circumstances, that we take care of those cremains the proper way afterwards? That's really key. So, I, you know, that's how I would sort of in a moment just sum up the key issues there.
But as we were saying at the beginning, this is not something that Thomas Aquinas had to think about. I mean, you know what I'm saying? like this is these new things come along, and someone has to reason them out morally.
You're absolutely right. And I mean, but isn't it beautiful how the church gives us so much to work with? I mean, in other words, our tradition, as time goes on, there's a sense in which our ability to fathom that tradition seems to go deeper. We seem to have a better handle, a more wide sense of the fullness of what the Lord has taught us through his revelation, through the lived experience now of 2,000 years. So, you know, when you get the question of should we be modifying the human genome, you have all kinds of considerations that will immediately bear on trying to answer that question. Or should we be doing alkaline hydrolysis?
Yeah.
Or how should we be dealing with end-of-life questions? So it's beautiful. The church, I think, gives us tremendous resources. And, you know, this is one of the reasons that I often say to people, it's worth your time to study these a little bit. And, you know, that's kind of what I do at the Bioethics Center. As you know, I'm the director of education there. So I run a certification program. I go around the country and I speak on these issues, just trying to get the word out and say to people, look, there's an incredible tradition here.
Yeah.
And once you get familiar with it, you're going to be, you know, finding a kind of liberation, even in the face of modern complexities.
Again, the number is 888-318-7884. If you have a biological, bioethics type question, you are very welcome to call. Anything from the very beginnings of human life to the very end of human life, and as Father just demonstrated, even after the end of human life, you are very welcome here, 888-318-7884. You don't have to be Catholic to call. Many people refer to those hundreds of years of Catholic thinking on these types of issues for help in solving and coming to the best conclusion on moral questions. And whoever you are welcome to take advantage of that. 888-318-7884. Father, you sent me this article from the Boston Pilot, the alternative newspaper in Boston. And I was struck that you sent it to me because I've noticed that often when we talk about the care for the dying, whatever setting I've seen that talked about, whether it's here on the air or in an in-person setting, there's always people who are thinking, did I do the wrong thing, you know, in caring for my parents at the end? The doctors said, withhold this or do that, and now I reflect upon it with a cooler head, and I don't know. I think there's a lot of people who are living with upset and anxiety about things that have already happened maybe a decade ago with a dying loved one. You get those kind of calls. People call and ask you about that.
We sure do. It's you know, I would say it's with a certain regularity we get those calls. And I always feel, you know, sad when somebody is troubled by the way that a family member may have died. I also understand the complexity in the sense that a lot of times you have some family dynamics that are playing out. You may have one of the siblings, you know, who's sort of lording over the whole process and insisting it has to go a certain way, and another one of the siblings doesn't agree. And, you know, they may not be getting clear indications from the medical team, from the medical professionals about how they should proceed. And they may not have a lot of background. This may be the first time somebody in the family or somebody close to them has died and
right.
had to deal with the complex medical issues. So, yes, it comes up, and I think people look back on it afterwards. They come to us, they say, gee, can you help me think this through? And I always have to point out to them, well, look, if this is something that happened a while ago, a lot of the medical facts and details are sort of lost in the winds of history. You don't have the medical record right in front of you. You know, you didn't talk to the doctor yesterday. Many of the details have faded. So it's going to be hard to really sort it out. But at the same time, I sometimes after talking with people and letting them give me the whole story, share what they do remember, I'll say to them, well, I don't know that we can resolve, you know, whether there were some errors made here on your part or not. Maybe there were, maybe there weren't. But I can say to you, if this has been something that's been nagging you, troubling you for a long time, maybe you should bring it to confession. You know, just clear the decks with the Lord Jesus. If there was a misstep somewhere, if you were, you know, just you weren't on your game and you were not thinking right, and you know that, this is what I think you should do. And then put it behind you so it doesn't badger you for another 5 years going forward. You know, the Lord's healing graces are like that, and we need to avail ourselves of them sometimes, even when there may be some element of ambiguity.
You know, we don't we grow morally usually by practice, and you know, but we don't get a lot of practice with death. Most people, you know, one or two people in their entire lifetime will they be responsible for at their time of death, if that. So, you know, almost, this is what always strikes me about it as a moral situation, is it's a highly fraught moral situation in which almost everyone involved in it, this is the first time that they've done it, they've gone through it.
I think that's right. That's so often the case. It's new. Everything is new. And there's a lot of stress associated with that. And, you know, there's a lot of complexity, too. I mean, sometimes, depending on how the person is dying, looking just at the medical choices, what about this surgery? What about this drug? What about moving them to hospice now? Et cetera, et cetera. It gets really fraught for people when they have not done this regularly. Now, sometimes you'll have a family member who will be a nurse or connected to the medical profession, and that can be a help with those purely medical questions. But then there's still going to be some other ones about, well, gee, you know, we don't know about the feeding tube. What are the moral lines of duty here? Should we be providing it? I mean, it doesn't look like they're going to be dying imminently, but they're certainly not eating. Or at least not eating very much. How do we figure all that out? So it does tend to have an element of novelty. And I mean, the other fact is that each of us dies in a slightly different manner. And that just has to be rolled into the way that we work through it and recognize that it's going to be case by case. You know, I remember Dr. John Haas, our former president at the Bioethics Center, he said, you know, when you've gone through one of these end-of-life cases, you've gone through one of these end-of-life cases.
That's right, right. Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's very sensible. So for those who are carrying that weight around, maybe take it to confession. Maybe it's time to go.
Yes,
let it go.
Yes. I think that's salutary advice. And, you know, to understand at the end of the day that the Lord wants us all to find healing for whatever our situations, whatever our mistakes have been, that's always the bottom line. So we shouldn't hesitate there.
Father Tad Pacholczyk is our guest from the National Catholic Bioethics Center. If you have bioethics question, whether you're Catholic or not, if you have a question about a bioethics issue, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All mystic monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase mystic monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
He is only one of four popes honored as the great.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
St. Leo I was pope at a time when Roman civilization was being overrun by barbarian armies. He stood as a light in the darkness and even saved the city of Rome from destruction by Attila and the Huns. Leo died in 461.
To find out more, visit EWTN.com and click on Catholicism.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Our guest is Father Tad Pacholczyk. It's always a great pleasure when he is here. It's a great pleasure because he's an awful delightful person to talk to, but also because as a scientist and a priest and a man well-educated in the moral teaching of the Catholic Church, is able to answer some of the really hard questions for us. So if you got your hard questions on any aspect of bioethics, you're welcome to call today, 888-318-7884, 888-31-TRUTH. Father, we have callers, so all right, we head to the phones.
Excellent. Look forward to it.
Tim in Springfield, Illinois, listening on Totus Tuus Radio. You are numero uno today, Tim. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Hey, Father Ted, thank you for your ministry, first of all.
Well, thank you, Ted.
We get your newsletter, and it's always informative, and your website is so helpful because I work in the pro-life movement, so I'm always looking for guidance from you guys.
Excellent.
My question is, what do you think the impact of artificial womb technology will be on the abortion industry, and how close are we? I saw an article this week about that technology advance, and I know that some of that can be done and is being done in the agricultural industry, but this was quite a bit more specific to human embryos.
Yeah, Tim, I think the science is moving, I would say, rather impressively on this question. You're right, a lot of the work is, in fact, most of the work, if not all of it, is being done in animals currently, as it should be. This should always be done first in animal models before we shift over to any kind of human attempts. And I think, you know, that the problem of actually having an artificial womb or an artificial uterus that could gestate from the very earliest stages, I think that's going to actually, in the end, prove to be technically pretty darn hard to achieve. It's, you know, so much happens during those 9 months of gestation, and it's such a delicate arrangement. But I do think we're going to be able to go earlier than the point of viability. And I think we're probably close to being, you know, ready to do that, where you can have babies that would be delivered prior to viability. Normally they would die, and you could stick them into a machine and they would survive and, you know, be helped by that. So very sophisticated incubator, if you will. That's really what we're talking about at this stage of the game. And the date of rescue, if you will, getting earlier and earlier for these babies as the technology marches forward. So your bigger question is, you know, is this going to affect abortion? And I think it will have to affect the debate, because if you have somebody who is saying, well, I'm 15 weeks pregnant and I want to get an abortion, and then somebody says, well, we've got a machine where we can take your baby out and save the baby, you know, will you let us do that instead of you having the abortion and directly ending the life of the child? It's going to at least enter the dialogue somewhere. Now, I think sometimes there are people who are like, well, doesn't matter if you can rescue my baby. I just want to make sure the baby is not around and I don't have the responsibility to do anything in terms of raising that child. That's part of the reason, you know, I have college plans, etc. But then, you know, you can go in other directions. What about adopting if this were to happen? So I do think these questions will occur. They will arise. I think, you know, there are going to be ethical concerns immediately too, because the notion of taking a perfectly healthy pregnancy and pulling the baby out and subjecting the baby to enormous risk by placing them into a machine and hooking them up, you know, to nutrients, that's risky. It's clearly risky for the baby. So you're only going to be able to do that, I suspect, in extremely extenuating kinds of circumstances where you have, you know, really moral certitude that that baby is destined for destruction at the hands of somebody, and this is the only way to save them. So I do think it's going to impact the dialogue, but I don't know exactly how to predict, you know, all the effects once we do have that technology more readily at hand. So I hope that's helpful, Tim.
Tim, I'm going to leave it there because every line has filled up with questions, so we'll try to make sure we get to everybody. We're talking bioethics. Our guest is Father Tad Pacholczyk, and we go off to Boise, Idaho now. Boise, Idaho, listening on Salt and Light Radio. Rebecca, go ahead with your question for Father.
Thank you. Father Ted, you have such a calming voice. I just have to tell you that. It's just so calm.
No, thank you, Rebecca.
My question is this. Those of us that have children or those that have family members that are experiencing the depths of cancer and the ravages of that disease, and are currently doing clinical studies. And we have, as a parent, we don't know oftentimes what those studies involve or what products they're using, or if they're using, stem cells or, other forms of treatment that maybe go against the teachings of the church. How do we as Catholics, parents, when our children are not Catholic, kind of rectify that? How do we understand that, and how do we put that into context for our own Christian life? Because we're not the ones that are receiving the treatment, but our child is.
Right. And I think, first of all, the question is, how do we get information about particular procedures? And you're asking, especially in the context of cancers and maybe pediatric cancers. I do think it's absolutely legit to inquire of the healthcare team that would be working, with your child or your friend's child, and just ask some of these questions. Can you tell me more about this or that proposed treatment? And a lot of times you can get some information that way. The other thing, the internet actually does have amazing resources. I was looking, for example, the other day at a new cancer treatment that involves what's called CAR T cells. And this is a very sophisticated $200,000 type of a treatment for certain types of blood cancers. And, I was just checking into it, and I didn't find anything that was morally problematic around it. But the amount of material that was on the internet dealing with CAR T cells was impressive. And I realize it had a, long history of development. There's a lot of scientific papers on it, et cetera. So you can use those resources as well. And, one other thing, if you find something, I mean, many people themselves are not scientists, and so they say, well, if I have this particular paragraph that I ran into, and it sounds like maybe there's some embryonic cells or something, and you're not sure, if you want to cut and paste that paragraph and send it to us through our consultation service at the National Catholic Bioethics Center, we will be happy to take a look at it and give you, our read of that particular subsection of whatever resource you found. That's sometimes a good way as well to find out if there was a problem with embryonic type stem cells instead of, say, adult stem cells not raising any moral problems, but the embryonic ones doing so. So those would be my kind of broad recommendations, Rebecca, in terms of your question. Does that make sense?
It does make sense. And my child is an adult child, so she makes her own decisions in that way. And it's like, I, as a parent, just am so concerned because she does not consider sometimes where the source of some of that treatment does come from, whether she's just grasping at straws to lengthen her, life here. And I understand that she's got small children, but nonetheless, it's still, I get so concerned because it's, to what extent does one go?
I think, Rebecca, you're right. Also in this sense that when we do have in the future some stem cell, meaning embryonic stem cell treatments that are available, they will become available in the future. There's no question. We've already seen in diabetes, there appears to be the possibility of using embryonic stem cell derivatives. And, those types of treatments, I'm convinced we as Christians can't go there. If you had to destroy a young human being, kill someone else in effect, in order to get a therapy, that raises a kind of clear moral boundary that we should not transgress. So it's good that you're raising the question, and we as Catholics need to be sensitive to this emerging reality within biomedicine today. And we should also make our voices heard in the sense of saying, look, we can't be developing these types of therapies going forward. We need to encourage scientists to develop ethically clean, ethically acceptable, ethically upright treatments for all of us.
Rebecca, thank you very, very much, and God bless you. Many prayers for you and your daughter. Father, is this part of the kind of the way we will have to witness as Christians, in a certain sense, refusing to take even things that could save our lives because they've taken the lives of another person?
You know, I believe so. I really do. I personally believe that that's the kind of situation that calls for a resolve and determination in the face of some of these developments. But we have to be clear that when we're talking about actually having killed for the purpose of making the treatment, that's what we're referring to.
But that is what you think is coming.
I do, absolutely.
Father Tad Pacholczyk, our guest, we're talking bioethics. Your questions are very welcome. 888-318-7884, 888-31-TRUTH. Right back with more with Father Tad on Catholic Answers Live. The recent decision by the U.S. Supreme Court to overturn Roe v. Wade was a monumental victory for the pro-life movement. But the fight is far from over. With our new booklet, Why We're Pro-Life, we have produced the perfect tool to prepare you to have peaceful and convincing conversations to shed light on the truth about human life from conception to natural death. Catholic Answers is printing millions of copies of this booklet, and we plan simply to give them away. You can help us in two ways. First, by generously supporting this project. 25 cents prints one book. $2,500 prints 10,000, and so on. Second, by helping us distribute the booklet through your parish, your school, or the pro-life ministry you work with. Catholic Answers is going to blanket the country with Why We're Pro-Life, but only if you step up and help us. Thank you so much. For more information, visit whyweareprolife.com.
Want to know more about the origins of the Catholic Church? Joe Heschmeyer explores the beginnings of Christianity in The Early Church Was the Catholic Church. Joe digs deep into the words and actions of those who lived right after the apostles to refute anti-Catholic claims of how the faith was lived back then. Order your copy of The Early Church Was the Catholic Church today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
As Catholic apologetics have gotten stronger, Protestant responses have gotten stronger as well. And now they have their own answers to rebut the standard Catholic proofs. Don't fret, we've got you covered. In his new book, Meeting the Protestant Response, apologist Carlo Broussard gives well-reasoned biblical answers to Protestant comebacks. Order your copy of Meeting the Protestant Response today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Hi, this is Janet Williams. Please join us for Women of Grace tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern here on EWTN Radio. Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. We're talking bioethics this hour. The National Catholic Bioethics Center does wonderful work helping to think through and help other people to think through sometimes very, very questions that are very, very difficult and need very, very precise distinctions made. That's what they do there at the National Catholic Bioethics Center. We've referred many people there who have asked us a question that we're not really clear on how to answer it here, and so we send them to the real professionals over there on answering those questions. And you're welcome to call and ask Father Tad Pacholczyk, who's the Director of Education at the National Catholic Bioethics Center. If you have a bioethics question, something about the beginning of life, something about treatments during the course of life, or dealing with disabilities, or things that have to do with the end of life, they're all welcome. 888-318-7884. Going to Colorado now. Jennifer in Colorado, listening on 104.3 FM. Jennifer, you are next. Go ahead with your question for Father Tad Pacholczyk.
Hi there, Father. I have a question. It's maybe a little ultra specific, but I work in clinical trials, and part of that, you know, is consenting women of childbearing potential. And part of many of the trials means they have to be on a highly effective method of birth control. And I'm kind of wondering, and abstinence is sometimes an option, but not always an option. And I'm wondering what what are the ethics related in my consenting them as a Catholic? Like, should I not be doing that if abstinence is not an option and contraception is the only option?
Excellent question, Jennifer. And yeah, one can sort of feel the dilemma there. So, yes, we get these questions in terms of sometimes setting up the clinical trial. And we will remind people that it's really important to make sure that abstinence is an option, because otherwise what's happening is there's a kind of coercion. Look, you're not going to get this trial drug unless you agree to be on two forms of contraception at the same time, mm-hmm. or something like that. And that's right. that really does pressure those individuals into participation and into the path of an immoral choice. So if you have a situation where there is the option of abstinence and you're wondering, okay, can I, as a researcher here, take consent from this individual, and can I mention that it would be allowable from the scientific point of view for them to take the contraception, and all you're doing is sort of verifying that they've signed something, but they definitely had the option of abstinence present, there's not a problem with you just verifying that they've signed something like that. But you can't be encouraging in any way that people go down the path of using contraception in these types of studies. So that's where it's going to get tricky. If you have a study that the only option that's presented to participants is you have to use two methods of contraception, sign the dotted line, you should not allow yourself to be drawn into participation, even in terms of the taking of the consent there, because that does involve you in some causal fashion in making that contribution to a later commission of the evil by the participant in the study. So I hope that's clear. It's you know, a little bit of a subtlety, but I mean, it's important that we who have any kind of say in establishing or setting up new clinical trials make sure that there are morally valid options available for the participants in those situations. And, you know, maybe it's just worth mentioning that the reason for all of this is that some of these drugs that are being tested on people may have what are called teratogenic effects and, you know, cause birth defects, etc. And that would be the reason that a lot of times this pressure will be brought to bear on the participants in the study and asking them to consent to not get pregnant. So, you know, if the language can be general, like you consent and I agree that I will not get pregnant during the course of this study, again, that's not going to raise a problem in terms of you doing the informed consent. But if it's only, you know, contraception, direct contraception, then you have to look for a way to maneuver around that.
So could I perform other study procedures other than the consent for that particular study? Or should I just try to recuse myself from the entire study?
I think it's going to depend on what those other elements are. What would be an example?
Mm-hmm. Well, the example would be, you know, we get the study. It says in it that you have to be on two highly effective methods of birth control. There's no option for abstinence. So, right, so it's not morally okay for me to consent a person and advise them of that, but if I have my coworker consent them and then I perform other study procedures that have nothing to do with contraception, is that okay?
Yeah. Just give me an example of what would be one of those other procedures that you would do.
Vital signs like blood pressure, heart rate, take an ECG, take blood.
Yeah, no, that shouldn't raise any problem. Now, you asked a question, okay, though, which I don't want to miss there, which is important.
Mm-hmm.
You said, can I just ask a coworker to do this? You have
right.
to be careful, because this may be a form of making a referral. And we don't want to make a referral for a morally evil action, because then we remain in the causal chain that leads to the commission of the evil. So you shouldn't do that either. You should have an understanding ahead of time with your supervisor, with your PI, your mm-hmm. principal investigator, that if a situation arises where there is not an option of abstinence, I don't want to be drawn into or requested to do the consent part of it.
Okay, I understand.
Thank you, Jennifer. Thank you very, very much. It's so fascinating because that's a study that the study itself has nothing to do with contraception, but it ends up involving the person because they just don't want us to have any legal connection with a child that might be hurt in the womb. But
exactly,
boy, it gives you a kind of an insight into people working in the biological sciences. There's just a lot of things to look out for.
Isn't it true? And, you know, I think sometimes what happens, I deal with graduate students, for example, who are moving into labs that are doing research. And at the beginning, they don't have an awareness of what's going on. And then as time passes, it dawns on them, oh, gee, I may be in a kind of compromised situation here. What do I do? How do I back out? Who do I talk to? You know, and it becomes an opportunity for them to grow in their faith, to talk with the supervisor, set up some parameters, etc. And but it is complicated.
But boy, we need them there, though. I would really feel bad if that discouraged some young person from getting involved in the biological sciences. Because no, if you are a good, strong moral person, maybe even especially a person of faith, then we do need you there.
Yeah, Cy, you're absolutely right. And I always try to encourage people and say, look, you need to perhaps keep your head down as much as you can as you go through your formation. You don't stick your head way up high and get it lopped off. But don't compromise yourself either in any fundamental way. And because later, if you can become, for example, a PI, a principal investigator, and you've got your own lab, you know, you can affect your colleagues in such important ways. You can give such powerful witness. And we need Catholics at all levels, all strata of research and science today. It's just critical.
Let's go to Jennifer. Thank you very much for the call. I do hope that was helpful to you. I'm going to go to Southern Illinois now. Mike, listening on Covenant Radio in Southern Illinois. Mike, go ahead with your question for Father Tad Pacholczyk.
Yeah, first of all, I wanted to thank National Catholic Bioethics Center for helping me probably about 15 years ago with an issue I had working for Merck and a vaccine issue that came up and promoting that. And then secondly, my question is insulin at the end of life considered a necessity?
Okay. Good question, Mike. So I'm presuming that you're in a scenario where somebody maybe, I don't know, they have cancer, they also have diabetes, they've been on insulin for a while, maybe for many years to regulate their blood sugar. And now, as the end is approaching, you're kind of saying to yourself, do we need to continue to use insulin, or could we stop it, you know, discontinue it? And this might even have the effect then of precipitating their death sooner. So the way to answer these kinds of questions is to look at the benefits and the burdens. So let's maybe start with the burdens here. This individual who's dying may have been on insulin for years or decades with very little in the way of side effects, because insulin is a natural molecule that our body makes anyway. And there really aren't many burdens to speak of, but the benefits are huge in the sense that it allows for regulation of your blood sugar, so your blood sugar doesn't, you know, go through the roof and damage all your organs. And that's a huge, huge benefit. So the question would be, at the end of life, why do we want to discontinue something that is beneficial and doesn't really have any burdens associated with it? Because as you can imagine, Mike, I sometimes get similar questions about blood pressure meds. They'll say, well, grandma's dying, she's been on these blood pressure meds for 25 years, and we're just thinking, you know, it's only a matter of a few days until she dies, so shouldn't we just stop giving her blood pressure meds? And it's like, well, why? I mean, they have worked for 30 years, or however long she's been on them, and they'll continue to work until she dies. She's dying from something else. There's no real burden associated with the use of these blood pressure meds. And if you cut them out, and it does sort of speed things up here, Why would you want to do that? You only want to do that if you have some burdensome aspect of the treatment. So, you know, if she had an allergy to the blood pressure medicines and she was breaking out in hives, well, then, yeah, that's a different story. Then you say, okay, we don't have to do that. So I think similarly for the insulin, one would provide these relatively non-burdensome treatments until the person passes on.
Mike, does
anything in the last 20 to 30 years, affect the thoughts on that?
Does anything in the last 20 to 30 years affect the thoughts? How do you mean?
Yeah, medical advancement or anything of that nature. An alternative question would be if insulin was basically the only thing keeping this person alive.
That's actually what insulin does. I have a friend who's a diabetic, and insulin keeps her alive. It's kept her alive since her 20s. She's now 60. Insulin is the only thing that's keeping her alive, so to speak. That's what insulin does. That's why it's a miracle drug. That's why it's so powerful and so impressive and such a wonderful development of biotech. So it's the kind of thing that makes sense to use when your own body no longer is capable of producing its own insulin. This is where medicine becomes one of these incredible blessings. So we need to provide what constitutes a beneficial, highly beneficial treatment with very little burden associated with it, even towards the end of life, unless there's some indication that the treatment itself has become unduly burdensome, unpleasant, painful, etc. In that case, then we could, review it and say, okay, we don't have to continue this. So that was the example with the blood pressure meds that, you have now maybe somebody with an allergy or some other contraindication that arises near the end of life. Well, all right, then maybe you will be able to scale back on that blood pressure medicine. Insulin, I really wouldn't see hardly any cases where that's likely. I don't know of people having allergies, for example, to insulin. Go ahead.
I was just going to say thanks to Mike and say just what you were about to say. I hope that that helps, but we have to take the break. We're talking bioethics, and I'm fairly certain we have room for one or two more callers. We'll get to the callers we have. I don't want you to think I'm not going to get to you. But after that, there's still room for one or two more callers before we have to say goodbye to Father Tad. So if you have a bioethics question, 888-318-7884. Right back with more Catholic Answers Live and Father Tad Pacholczyk right after this.
It's all about the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
More to Life is all about exploring what it means to live the Catholic difference in everything we do.
Our goal is to help people see that when they are connected to His grace, there is so much more to life.
More to Life with Dr. Greg and Lisa Popchak. Tomorrow morning, 10 a.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Do you love sharing the gospel and want to learn to be more effective? Join the St. Paul Street Evangelization Online School of Evangelization. You will learn to build bridges of trust and make disciples by befriending strangers, proclaiming the gospel, inviting people to the church, and praying with others. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you are unable to give, we'll give you a membership at no cost. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. If you need help with bioethics questions, end-of-life issues, beginning-of-life issues, care for the disabled or the sick, the National Catholic Bioethics Center is a wonderful resource. You can find them at ncbcenter.org, ncbcenter.org. Our guest is the Director of Education at the National Catholic Bioethics Center, Father Tad Pacholczyk, both a scientist and a priest, and your calls are welcome if you have a question about the ethics of any biological intervention. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Going to Minnesota now, Michelle in Minnesota, listening on Real Presence Radio. Michelle, thank you for your call. Go ahead with your question for Father Tad.
Oh, good evening, gentlemen. Thank you, Father Chad. My question is pertaining to my mother who has Alzheimer's. She's also been on dialysis for kidney failure for several years now. And so our question as a family will be how long as the Alzheimer's continues to progress, how long does she, do we allow the dialysis to continue to? It's three times a week, and it's she benefits, definitely keeping her alive, and she's not suffering from the dialysis, but again, our concern is that as the Alzheimer's progresses, that's going to become burdensome for her. So I'd like your take on that.
Yeah, great question, Michelle. I mean, I'd start out by making the observation, maybe just as a point of distinction from the prior caller, that dialysis itself clearly does have more burdens associated with it than, you know, just getting a quick shot of insulin or just being hooked up to an insulin pump, as many people are, in the sense that, as you said, it's three times a week. Typically, you've got to sometimes transport a person to another place. You have a fistula that's under your skin that's used. Sometimes there can be, you know, difficulties accessing it. And so the burdensomeness, there's definitely a higher degree of burdensomeness associated with it. There are obviously very powerful benefits that are associated with it as well. So the question in your case is going to, I think, hinge on how things go. In other words, this is a dynamic assessment, and as her condition gets worse, you know, from dementia, from the Alzheimer's, there may be some new complications that arise. You know, as the brain undergoes more dysfunction, sometimes other bodily systems start misbehaving. And sometimes people, for example, who do dialysis regularly will be able to do it pretty well for a long time, but at a certain moment, they don't have the ability to tolerate the dialysis well going forward. They may have big swings in their blood pressure, for example, and they may kind of black out as they're being dialyzed and other things. And so if those types of things happen, then you're going to be saying, all right, on the burden side of things, the burdens are more here. And at a certain point, if, you know, those burdens become really significant, it will be morally okay to discontinue the dialysis. And, you know, you have to assess that kind of in real time, and it'll often depend on other specifics of how a person is doing and what the comorbidities are, etc. But there definitely can be a point at which dialysis will no longer make sense to continue, and the family can opt to discontinue it. So I can't answer, you know, your question specifically, because it depends on the details of exactly what happens, you know, for your mom going forward from this point. And you'll have to sort of take it, you know, one day at a time, one stretch at a time. But I think it'll become clear with the Lord's help. You'll understand that as these burdens start to appear, oh, yeah, you know, and maybe she'll have some other things, like maybe she'll have, who knows, liver failure or some other organ failure. And you'll say to yourself, you know, now even the issue of moving her from one place to another to get dialyzed is itself a burden, also because she's so elderly, dot, dot, dot. So all the details will be part of your assessing that point at which you realize the dialysis has become, as we call it, heroic and no longer morally required.
You know, even in your generalization, it absolutely makes sense. I'm comforted. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, you're very welcome, and I'll say a prayer for your family.
Thank you, Michelle. I'm going to go kind of quickly to Joan. I would like to get everybody on if I can with Father Joan in Northwest Washington State, listening on Sacred Heart Radio. Joan, welcome. Go ahead with your question for Father Tad.
Oh, thank you. I want to express my gratitude to Father Tad for the very important work he's doing. I'm a 75-year-old Catholic woman, and I have no family members to help me at the end of my life with medical directives. So I'm at the age where I may have a stroke or a heart attack or some other event and be hospitalized. What is there available, if anything, to help me so that my Catholic faith is honored when I'm in a hospital bed?
Yeah, excellent question, Joan. I really think if you do not have family around who you can call on or ask to be an advocate for you, to be your healthcare proxy, think about your friends. And specifically, you know, at your church, do you have connections? Is there someone you could ask there who you trust, who you could say, please, can I, you know, designate you as my healthcare proxy in case I do have a stroke at some point in the future? Because you're right to say this is important. I need to have somebody. I think everybody should choose their healthcare proxy. They should designate who this person is. And in doing that, then you have sort of set the glide path into making some good and appropriate decisions or having them made on your behalf if you're not able to. Remember also that if you do find somebody who's willing to do this, it's good to have some discussions with them. Tell them about your, you know, concerns to respect the faith and your interests in not having heroics or, you know, however you want to phrase it. But I think it's good to have these discussions and dialogues ahead of a crisis actually arising.
Joan, how's that?
Oh, very good. Thank you very much, Father.
You're welcome, Joan. God bless you.
Thank you, Joan. Thank you very, very much. Father, we ended up with about 60 seconds for you to tell us about the National Catholic Bioethics Center. What kind of things are available there? What kind of services, educational opportunities, that kind of thing?
Yes, well, I do run a certification program, so if people are interested in doing a one-year online program, they should check out our website, ncbcenter.org. And I want to mention a new video series that I'm starting. It's on vimeo.com, and if you do //, that is, bioethics videos, it'll take you right there. And there's a nice kind of extended discussion of some of the things we've talked about today, end-of-life decision-making. Its focus is called The Gift of Dying Well. And so it was a talk I gave in Detroit and was filmed by a professional film crew. So people should be aware of that also if they're dealing with a family member, perhaps, who's dying at the moment.
So you go to vimeo.com, and then you put the slash, and then...
Bioethics videos.
All right. Good. Darren, we'll put that in the show notes. So if anybody needs it, they can go to Catholic.com and just click on this show at the bottom there. It tells you the various things that were mentioned. National Catholic Bioethics Center in Pennsylvania, Father, a priest of the of Fall River, Massachusetts, however, which I think of you as a saint leaving Fall River, Massachusetts to go work elsewhere, Father.
I don't know about that.
Well, it's an awful nice place to leave. Father, may we have your blessing and our listeners have your blessing before we go.
Yes, absolutely. May Almighty God bless you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Father Tad Pacholczyk, thanks so much. It's always such a great pleasure to have you here.
Well, thank you too, Si. Just wonderful to work with you.
And I hope we'll see you many more times this year. Have we scheduled them, Darren?
I'm willing.
Okay, we're scheduling them. We're in process. All right. Tomorrow is Tim Staples, and it's open forum. So we'll be taking one question each hour. Call early. 888. Nah, we'll see you tomorrow, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.